Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you for your presence here. Lord, I thank you for your anointing, Lord, to heal the sick, to raise the dead. Lord, I pray. It's not what I say, Lord, Father, but what you reveal to people by your Spirit, by your word of truth, by your word of grace and mercy here tonight. Lord, I pray people receive it in their hearts, Father, to change them, Father, to understand you more, Lord, Father. Lord, your word says all you get understanding. Lord, I pray understanding will come. Lord, Father, it will change mindsets, the belief systems. Well, Lord, will change. Lord, freedom and liberty will come tonight, Lord, not of a man, but of Jesus the Christ, the anointed one and his anointing, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Father, Holy Spirit. I pray you've anointed me to preach and to teach and do the gospel of grace and of the kingdom of God, Lord. So I pray, use me mightily here tonight, Lord. My lips, my hands, my ears, my eyes, everything. Lord, I pray that the revelation will come. Even as I preach, new revelation will come, Lord, Father, to make us all free, Lord, Father, in Jesus' precious, awesome name. I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I want people to understand, last week was the first bit of intro. It was a long intro. I'm not going to go through it again. It was just for an hour and 10 minutes was just intro. But the whole concept is I want people to understand that God is a God of family. He's not a God that wants to be served and must be served and all those things, okay? It's a God that came to serve us, okay? That's the whole idea. The whole idea as well that I want to break off people's belief systems. Because we have so much belief systems in us. Even the Lord tells me so many times, and say, Johan, you are still religious. And I say to people, and I say to the Lord, I ain't no religious. I'm the least religious person I can think of. But then God comes, Jip, Johan, you're still religious. I say, okay, Lord, I repent. And God shows me things in my life, change my belief systems concerning things, you know. So you will always hear me. That's why we keep on changing and getting better teachings and better understanding concerning of the Word. It doesn't mean everything that we teach or everything is wrong, but it's just better. Do you understand? So in the whole concept, I just want to quote something quickly. Hebrews 12 verse 28. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. In other words, we need grace to truly serve God. But that serving is not us bowing down to God. It's actually God bow down to us. Okay? Because if you hear last week, it means... there's a word in Genesis 1:28, when God blessed them, okay? And blessed them and said, multiply and be fruitful. And what happened, that word is barak. It means God kneeled down and he blessed Adam. He blessed male and female, he blessed them. It was a prophetic utterance for the new. And he actually made us by blessing and kneeling down and making and blessing us. So he came to serve us. Jesus was the feet of the disciples. He came to serve, not to be served. Okay? But understanding this whole concept should humble you even more. To serve, to worship, to adore. Do you understand? It's not this prideful, boastful thing. Oh God, you get to serve me and you like this. None of that stuff. It should humble you. Understanding what he has done. That, you know, the Bible says in Philippians, he didn't make it robbery, being equal with God, Jesus. So aren't we also the same? You know, so I went through a lot of stuff and the whole thing of concept, we're going to get into it more and more, but the basis, the intro, is that God is family orientated. He's not, we are serving him orientated, you know. You don't have kids. The reason why you want to have kids is they must serve you. I mean, that's bad. Okay? So let's have a lot of kids so they must serve you, bring you coffee, do your stuff, whatever, work and work and work. You sit on your butt and do nothing. I mean, that's not how it is. That's bad. Okay? So you need to understand that that is the whole concept of God. God is family orientated. And that's about grace. In this whole thing of grace is also family. And family is about grace. God is the Father. His Father also chastens, God also rebukes and that kind of stuff. But not in sickness, disease, death, or poverty, or anything like that. We need to understand, but through His Word. So we went through all of the stuff. I'm not going to go into that, but for us to understand now this beautiful concept of grace. Okay? But I want to go, and I want first for us to see and understand a little bit about law and about grace. Okay? I want us to see, right, you will see mainly Paul in the New Testament, you write 2/3 of the Bible, of the New Testament, he mainly preach no more law. If you read from Romans straight through, you see continuously talks about law, you know, no more law, grace. He was totally want to tell people there's no more law, okay? And you can say, yeah, but I'm not under the law, but I will show you how much law you still have within you, okay? And that's why we need to understand that there's things that needs to be broken down for us to move, but also to understand the basics, what Jesus did for us, and we'll move on further and further and further. Okay? But get the first intro CD. It's pretty cool. But I want to start a little bit today on Romans 3, and then 4, and 5, 6, 7, and 8. I don't think I'll do 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 tonight. I can, but you might have a problem. We'll be here 5 hours. Okay. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Romans 3:21, verse 26. I want you to see already. But remember, it's, you had Acts and then you had Romans. Remember the book of Acts. If you understand the book of Acts, they had no understanding yet of no law. They didn't understand grace really much. Do you understand? In book of Acts. There was no doctrine in place concerning that kind of stuff. To give you a bit of background and theology, okay? You'll see in the book of Acts, they messed up. I show you many places in the book of Acts, Handelinge, for the Afrikaans people, you know. you know, they messed up. But there was no doctrine in place, things in the place. And then Paul came and he started, and there was Romans, and there was 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Ephesians, Galatians, etc., 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 where there's more understanding, you know, concerning your part and how grace operates and all of these things, okay? So you need to understand it. So Romans starts off basically saying, listen, now enough with the law. And it says here, but now the righteousness of God apart from law is revealed. Okay, being witnesses by law of the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and all who believe. In other words, righteousness has come, you know what, through everybody. It's for all who believe, not just some people, but of everybody. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and fell short of the glory of God. In other words, every single person sinned. Jew, Gentile, Greek, Afrikaners, you name it. Everybody actually messed up, okay? Remember the first intro I tried to explain to people? What's so amazing about it, Adam sinned, we didn't sin, okay? But yet it affected us, okay? So it's actually Adam's fault. So God even has a lot of grace on us, okay? The Bible also says, you'll see later in Romans as well, that if one man infected so many people, I'll give you one's translation, affected so many people, how much more will now Jesus affect so many people? Much more. Am I right? So much more. I mean, people don't understand a lot of things in the Bible. They say, greater is the road that's narrow, less is the road that's narrow than the road that's wide. Many people go through the wide road than the narrow road, okay? We'll get into that and I give you more understanding about that. But the whole thing is, I cannot see hell is going to win. God is not a loser. Am I right? So why would hell win? I don't think so. Why would the devil win? Why will there be more people in hell one day than in heaven one day? I don't think so. But we've been taught wrong. Do you understand? So we need to understand certain things, okay? So we can change our belief system, our doctrines and stuff. It's being justified freely by grace, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as propitiation by His blood through faith to demonstrate His righteousness. Do you understand? It's all about His righteousness, and then of course He says accredited to us. Because in His forbearance, God has passed over the sins that were previously committed to demonstrate at the present time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. In other words, His whole idea is for us to be free, you know what, even from past whatever. Even the people from the past, the Bible says, even the people that sinned in Noah's day, you know what, Jesus even went to minister to them. Okay? So God made plan for everybody, okay, to be free. But the whole idea, we're going to look a bit at Abraham. Okay, we'll see this just now. But also verse 27, 31 says here, where is boasting then? It is excluded by what? Law or works? No, by the law of faith. In other words, he says here, so we then boast in our own works and stuff to get redemption, to be free. Still people today, how many times still today, you must fast, you must do so much stuff, so you can and then you will do. We must do the Passover, we must do Ascension Day, we must do Christmas Day, we must do Hay Day and High Day and Low Day. You know what? Otherwise, you know, you're not a good Christian, okay? It's still law. We still do things. I remember when I was still young, I read my Bible, especially on the 25th, so I can feel okay, of December, you know? People go to church on the 25th, whew, see, Lord, I didn't forget, you know? That kind of stuff. Or they feel if you don't go, that God's going to be angry and that kind of stuff. You know, Lord, I didn't forget you, you know? Still works-based that we have a lot. No, but by the law of faith. So what is the whole? What is the law of faith? It's believing. How do you? It's just to believe. Jesus did it. Jesus did everything for us. Everything He did for us. It's so easy to believe because He gave you faith to believe it anyway. It's very simple. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of the law. Or is He the God of the Jews only? Is He not also the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also, since there is one God who justifies the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. In other words, the circumcised means the Jewish people. Uncircumcised means, you know what, people is not of Jewish descent. So He justifies all in all. Do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. Okay. See, what's the good thing about the law, actually, because the people wanted to have the law, okay? If you look back in when it just came out of Egypt and stuff, then the law said, Moses gave them a law and so, and they said, are you sure you can do this? He said, we can certainly do this, you know? And God says, let it be today in your hearing. In my hearing, it will be so. So they wanted to have the law. They wanted to have these things to make them feel good about themselves, you know, in a manner they want to work out their salvation, because they serve God at that stage. So you must do serving God, you must do this, and do that, and then the gods will give you back this kind of thing. They come from a Babylonian system which messed up the whole scene, but they wanted that and so forth from the law. Okay, so God says, okay, I'll give you the law and so forth. But then Abraham came. So I want to go to Romans 4. Then Abraham came. I like the whole thing with Abraham because Abraham messed up the whole scene, actually. Because Abraham was actually, he didn't have the law. They had the law. Abraham didn't have the law. But the Jewish people still today like Abraham. But they want to teach Abraham from a law perspective. Do you hear what I'm saying? You can speak to Jewish people and so forth. They love Abraham. Even the Muslim people love Abraham. But they have no understanding that Abraham was not a man of law. He was a man of totally, utterly grace. Why? He just believed God. What is grace? How do you get grace? By believing. Grace is a free gift. Here it is. Just take it. No, I don't want it. Grace is a free gift. Your faith is just to receive it. You know, I always use the example to people, say, you know what, if Bill Gates comes in here and he says, you know what? I want to give you R1 million. What are you, going to believe him? So do you believe he has that kind of money to give? Okay, then I'll ask you this. What did you have to believe he says, here's a $1 million check, you take it? Do you have to believe it or did you just receive it? You just received it, didn't you? He says, here's the check because you know he's good for it. He gives you a check of $1 million or R1 million. You have now two choices, to take it or not to take it. There's no belief in it at all, you understand? But you trust him that he has it, isn't it right? You see, we make this the belief a work thing. We make this whole thing about God, we have to work our belief. We have to work our grace. We have to work to really trust God. Whereas just trust God. Simple as that. So that's what's nice about Abraham, because it says here in Romans 4. What then shall we say? Abraham, our father, was he found according to the flesh? If Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. In other words, he didn't work out his righteousness. Okay? It's like this. I try to explain it because the whole thing about God's busy reading to me is about family. If you have kids, do they have to believe that you are their father? Or do they know you are their father? Do you know that you're your mother? Or do you know that this is your father? Or do you have to believe this is your father? Do you have to believe this is your mother? Or do they have to believe, you know what? Do you have to believe this is my son? I believe this is my son. No. I believe this is my son. No, I believe this is my father. No, I believe this is. Or do you just know this is your father? Do you hear what I'm saying? I want people to understand that because we're getting this whole thing, we're getting to family. The Lord has shown me we missed the whole concept of God and family. Now, to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. He says, work the wage. In other words, if I work for something, if I work for you or for you, then you have to pay me. Am I right? Then it's not a free gift. I work for it. So give me my money. Do you understand? That's what people still do today. I have to work hard. I have to pray hard. I have to fast hard. I have to do things hard so that I can get. Because if I do it, then God, you see that I prayed hard, I fasted hard, I need. Do you understand? How many times, what must you do? Or what must your son or your daughter do, okay? To be more their son or daughter? Nothing. They are just your children. Do they have to work every day hard to be, you know, more of your son or more of your daughter? No, they're just your son and daughter. Are they sometimes naughty and stuff? Of course. But they still stay your son and your daughter. Do you understand what I'm saying? You need to understand that stuff. He says, yeah. But to him who does not work but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. In other words, I want you to explain it. When you came to Jesus, when you said, Lord, you are my Lord, my you received in that day, what other works do you have to do to become more righteous? What other stuff do you have to do to become more holy? What other stuff do you have to do to be more accepted? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Okay? Is there still principles and faith and you're still working out just things? Of course, yes. It's like your kid is growing up. He's now 3, 4, 5 years old or whatever. And in this process, he's busy learning you and you're busy learning him. Am I right? There is a learning and an understanding phase still happening. But there's still, this is my dad and this is my kid, that kind of stuff. But there's still a learning curve involved. Okay? See, we believe. In other words, we just trust God is good. We came to the Lord, why should it be anything different? God is a good God. Why would anything else be different for you? To believe for this or believe for that, whatever. But we work our beliefs too much. We work the principles and stuff too much. It's messing us up. We'll get into that more. But to whom does the work but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. Just as David also described the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works. Now he says to you, now he describes how blessed is this man that does not work, but just believes. You see, we only get blessing when we believe. What do we believe? Not working your belief, just to, Lord, I believe you. Not to go and pray for 10 hours to show that you believe. Do you understand what I'm saying? Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven. What did you have to work for your sins to be forgiven? You just receive God. The free gift. Okay? You know you can do it. That's all it is. And your sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. It's beautiful. Does this blessedness then come upon the uncircumcised only, but or upon the uncircumcised also? For we say that faith was accounted to Abraham for righteousness. How then was it accounted while he was circumcised or uncircumcised? Not while circumcised, but while uncircumcised. In other words, still the Jewish thing today. I want people to understand this. It's still law. How many times, Jesus ministered and healed people on the Sunday? It was a contrary to the law. He messed people up. He said, man, okay, so the circumcision happens on the eighth day. Now, the eighth day is on the Sabbath. Now, should I circumcise this boy or the girl? Or must I obey the Sabbath? I messed up the whole scene here. Now it's a contradicting. What must I do? You have to do nothing. You see, he messed up the whole thing. They still worked out law. Here was Abraham. God counted him for righteousness before he was circumcised. In other words, you know, the circumcision means to be set apart. That was a law thing. It was actually pointing to when Jesus is going to come and stuff. And says, what is a true Jew? The one that's not circumcised of the flesh, but of the heart. Okay, so a true Jew is a circumcised of the heart. Okay, in other words, he was accounted for righteousness. He didn't have to do anything. He just believed. And then afterwards he got circumcised. How many times still we in the charismatic church, we have to do, it's like people like baptism coming up now and stuff like that. No, you must first be baptized, then you can get filled with the Spirit of God. No, you can be filled with the Spirit of God praying in tongues, then you can be baptized. You can be baptized and Spirit filled with everything and saved in one day, 1 second, if it has to be. Do you understand? We still have various laws and traditions that's messing ourselves up. Do you understand? How many times we still work in a family, but it's not like if you're in a good godly family, okay? You have some things you're working out, but it's love involved and that kind of stuff. Your kid messes up. Now you know what? Oh, you messed up. Your kid says, "Dad, I'm so sorry, man." I says, "Don't worry, my son. I know you messed up, but come, let me help you." That is the whole idea of God. To understand the Lord. But we like, you know, you messed up. No, God's not going to He's not going to give that to you anymore. You must first go do ABC, then He will do ABC. Doesn't work that way. You understand? He is unconditional grace. We'll get into the certain principles where, you know, God put in place to help us, but you need to understand that. Because the Jewish people still, they love Abraham, but they have no understanding. That's why in the New Testament here, he quotes in the Old Testament. David, he quotes David, he quotes this kind of stuff. For when Jewish people say to you, or people say to you, no, we still have to keep Pentecost. Or we still have to do this day, Christmas day. Or I said, no. But Abraham didn't work, he just believed. And then he was counted for righteousness. He didn't do anything to be righteous. That believing just means receive. I just know it's okay. Thank you, Lord. You see, the whole thing of Abraham, why I like Abraham so many times, we minister him. He was actually not a man. He was actually worshiping the Son. The whole idea of Abraham, okay? So he was with his father for how many years? 80 years and stuff. And then he had this encounter with God. He just, God spoke to him. And he just knew this is the real God. But before that, he was a worshiper of the sun. Eh? If you go back and study the whole thing. So for him, just to believe this is God, and he says, I'm leaving my father. In other words, he didn't just, I'm just leaving my father. Just think of it. He was under his father's covering for 80 years. He didn't move. It's like you that struggles to move from your job. Oh, should I go? I don't know. Maybe I don't know. What must I do? Oh, I don't know. What are you doing? Oh, Lord, am I doing the right decision? I'm just using an example. He said, no ways. I heard the Lord. I'm leaving my father's stability. And I'm moving with my wife to a foreign land. And God didn't say, listen, you're going to get into the land, you're going to go to that city, you're going to go to that suburb, and you're going to go to that street, and you're going to that house. He didn't say that. He said, go that way. And he just took it into his heart because he knew this was the real God that will not let him down. And today, we as people must know this is the caring Father that we have. He will not let us down. He will not let us down. So he says here, 11, and he received the sign of circumcision as a seal of righteousness of faith, which he had while still uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all those who believe, though they are uncircumcised, that righteousness might be imputed also to them. In other words, it was just a seal. It wasn't a law thing while he was, it was just evident. It was a seal to say, listen, wait, there's still going to be more stuff coming. Okay? It was like a sign for him afterwards he got circumcised. It was a sign. It was not, now you must do it. Okay. And the father of circumcision to those who not only are of the circumcision, but also walk in the steps of faith, which our father Abraham had while still uncircumcised. It talks about it continuously. Because the Jewish thing is still uncircumcision. Snip, snip. You know? Enough. Okay? It's law. You know, not to be funny, just get you back to beautiful industry. You know, in Africa, a lot of the black people, I don't know if you guys know it, whatever, but especially up in Africa, in very much in the black culture, they do circumcision on kids, okay? When you're a baby and stuff like that. You know how many of the kids get mutilated? They damage their genitals. Thousands upon thousands every year. Do yourself a favor, go and do this research and see what they actually do to kids, how they circumcise them. They get some other palooka out to circumcise and have blunt instruments and they think it's hectic, they get infected and some of them actually die. I'm not kidding you. So really circumcision, you know, if it's for medical reasons, go for it, okay? Okay? But it's not a have to anymore. But it's hectic, just a bit of information. I mean, I think to myself, why would my father want to hurt me like that? I don't think so, okay? To prove that I'm now part of his clan. I don't think so. Verse 13, for the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law. In other words, the promises doesn't come through law. The Ten Commandments and your promises of God doesn't come how good you are. Or how bad you are. It comes because of what he's done. You'll see that more as well. We still feel inadequate concerning the things of the Lord. And we must stop that. But through the righteousness of faith. Okay. So the promises come, you know what, through faith. What is faith? Just believing, Lord, it is true. Nothing that you can work, not the Ten Commandments, not the seven steps, the five steps, none of this stuff. Fulfillment stuff is still basically people beginning to things more and more. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise made of no effect. And also the promise which was Jesus also coming. It says if we have to keep the law and we have to work out our salvation to get into heaven, I mean, then we don't need faith. We can just work out our own stuff. Remember, the world has this bad saying, you know what, God helps those to help themselves, which is a lot of kafui because we cannot help ourselves. John 15:5 says, apart from me, you can do nothing. Philippians 4:13 says, but now you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. There's everything through Him, and that should humble us more. He actually did everything and came to serve us. Okay? Because the law brings about wrath. For where there is no law, there is no transgression. Do you understand? And you will get into it more in 2 Corinthians and so forth. It says, and also in Romans, the law brings wrath. In other words, the law reviles all manner kinds of sin within me. It's what I try to explain to people. If I say to you, when I leave this place and there's a box, I say, please, I'm leaving this place, but don't look in that box. And I said, don't look in that box. I'm going away from, don't look in that box. Don't look in that box. Go and tell that to your kids. What are they going to do when you just walk out of the door? I'm going to look in that box. Because you just gave them a law. Do not eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. See, God didn't put that law into place. The reason why He said that is for you to have a free will. Do you understand? But in our consciousness and whatever, you know, in our minds, is that when we say don't, we go like, I'm going to. Huh? Let's be honest. Every single day here, every single one of us are transgressing law. Do you know that? Natural law. Every single one of us. If you drive a car, you've transgressed the law today. Every single one of us. Now, Johan, I keep this speed. You lie. You know there was a white line? You stop them with your. You shouldn't have put your wheel on that line. Do you know that? You're a bit over that line. Oh, you okay? You break the law today. Normal stuff. Huh? You had to quick off the robot. You broke the law. See, normal, simple stuff that you don't understand. And that's natural law that you actually physically break every single day. But you're not even aware of it. But you break it every single day. Okay? And in so many times as well. You are late. Oh, I have to go fast. You just break the law. You know? They put things in place and your nature is 120. No, I'm going to go 100 and how more? Okay, this stretch I can go 140 because I know there's no cops here. Okay. It's the way that we are. Okay? It shouldn't be, but it's not what it is. It's just because that's what the law brought. Okay? The whole thing with the law is, it says this, it says, once a year, they brought, you know, offerings to make them, you know, for the atonement of sins. Now imagine this. If you knew, that's what the law did, no? Much better than grace, much worse than grace. It makes you more sin. Grace helps you with your sin. In other words, they did remissions of sins for a year. Now imagine this. You know, if I turn all my sins now, I'm okay for the next year. So I can do what I want. I'm fine for the next year. What will that revive in you? If you can give something, okay, for the next year, I can kill, I can whatever, or, you know, I'm going to say kill, but, you know, you can do as bad stuff as you want. Because, you know, if you should die, you'll be in heaven. That's what the Lord did. It actually made them worse off because they know once a year, do my sins thing quickly, do my offerings, make sure everything's right. Okay, it's a bit embarrassing here, but okay, I can keep on sinning more. You see what the Lord did? This is what the Lord did. It made them sin even more. Then they understand, when you're under grace, if you have a father or mother or your kids, if you're a good father and a good mother and a good son or a good daughter, do you willfully want to hurt your dad or your father? Your father or your mother. But you sometimes make mistakes to hurt them, of course. You see, that's what grace will do. If you understand the Father's love, you don't want to willfully hurt him or, you know, him at all. You don't want to willfully hurt your mother or your kids want to willfully hurt you. That's what grace is like. That's what the whole family idea is with God. Therefore, it is our faith that it might be accounted to grace, so that the promise might be steward to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also those who are of faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. In other words, the whole promise didn't come just to the Jewish people, but to everybody. It's by faith, you know. And that you get the beautiful grace, you know. You know, I said to people, grace is it. Grace leads you. And God gave you faith to receive it anyway. Okay, but we still have to work stuff. I still see it a lot. Because I want to go through the stuff about law and about stuff that you need to understand. As it's written, I've made you a father of many nations, in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. In other words, he believed God. If there is nothing, Hebrews 11 says, God spoke out of nothing and he created something. You know? So imagine this. This is what Abraham believed. He believed God. He believed that God, you know what? You will even raise my son from the dead. He believed God. This is the hard thing for him to do. Very hard. But he believed God. He says here, whom counted to hope and hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations. According to what was spoken, so shall the descendants be. So he believed God. You know, it's like this word. That's why he held on to God's word. That's why this Bible is important for us. Especially in the beginning, getting to know the Lord. You must take these promises and hold it close to your heart. He says here, and not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old and in deadness of Sarah's womb. He says that was not weak in faith. He just believed the Lord. How many times you get a word of whatever and stuff like that, and it doesn't make sense to you at all because it doesn't look like it. I get also many times the Lord spoke to me, Johan, this and this, and I'm like, you're going to be kidding me. It just doesn't look like it, you know? The Lord says, you know what, I got a word many years ago, you know, I remember the first word I really got about finances, you know, it was Prophet James. He said to me, this was 10, 11 years ago, I can't remember a lot, a while back. And he said, I'm like, I received it and it was, the power of God knocked me silly. I was out. And he said, gold will be given to you in a vision for the kingdom of God and blah, 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 and so forth. And I thought to this man, you're crazy, man. I'm in debt. I've got this. And I've paid for my car. I don't know how I'm going to make it to this, whatever, you know what I'm saying. And it went worse. It didn't came better. But slowly but surely, that promise was slowly but surely starting to manifest. You know, I just believed the Lord. I said, I'm going to hold on to the word that you spoke to me. I'm holding on to that stuff, Lord. I believe you. You know, like if you have, that's why I'm trying to get you the family thing. If you are a good father or mother, especially when you are, say if you're a young boy or girl, you know what, and they really look up to you, you know. Man, you are the biggest, you are the strongest, you can tell them, man, you can tell them a lie. That I've just picked up 7 cars today and whatever. Yeah, daddy, you are, you can do that, you know what I'm saying? That's how they believe you. So let's believe God, the Father, which is our daddy, the same way. And say, God, you know what, you can pick up 7 sons, man. Not sons, but sons that you made them. Stop believing. I want us to see the Father as a Father. Because none of us had good fathers and stuff like that or good mothers, you know. So I want us to get into that. I want us to see that kind of stuff. The whole thing is to see God's unconditional grace concerning family. You know, same thing with Katie and stuff like that. I mean, Katie is not even my real son. But when I say certain things to him, just believe me. So it looked like this. Okay. You know? He starts looking at me and says, many times he says to me, ek gaan net so groot soos jy wees. I'm just going to be as big as you. My arms, I'm also going to be like you, you know? I'm also going to have a church one day. You see, he's looking up to me. So shouldn't we start looking up to God the same way? and see Him in the same way. You know? Because the same thing, if you are a righteous dad and a godly dad, you will not lie. Because I say to Kaden as well, and I said, do I lie? He says, never. I said, why do you lie? Because sometimes they lie. I said, you're lying. And I asked him this question, Kaden, do I ever lie to you? Have I ever? No. Because these people will say, but how would I know it's a lie? No. He knows. He knows because through my conduct, he has seen how I live, how I speak to my wife or his mother, and how I do some stuff. So he knows what I'm doing and what I'm saying is the same thing. Do you hear? We need to see that about the Father. We need to receive it in our hearts by the Father. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving God, giving glory to the Lord. In other words, he was praising God, although it has not manifested, and that helped him if there was unbelief. You see, when things going bad, we start that to, God is a good God. He's a good daddy. He's a good father, man. My father, he's an awesome dad. He is my dad. I will praise you, Lord. You are awesome. You came to serve me, but Lord, I thank you that I want to serve you. You see, once I understand, the Bible talks about that a bond servant. Now, the bond servant means after a while, what they did is you only by the law you could only keep a servant for a specific year. Okay, I think for 7 or for 14 years. I'm not sure. Maybe every 7 or 14 years. Then after you want to let them go, he says you've bought your freedom. Now you can go. That servant has a choice. To leave or say, listen, you're a good master and I want to stay with you. And that servant becomes a bond servant. He actually gets an earring. Okay? What happens is that they put the, that's why you know the post of the lamp, when the Egypt, they came and they put the blood on the lintels and stuff like that. It's the same principle. What they did is they put the ear by the lintel and they put the whole, and then they get like an earring. Like blood goes through and whatever, it's like a covenant. Now they are willfully bondservant to that master because that master is a good master. So they want to serve him because he was so good to them. That's how we should be. Okay? Willfully and loving God and want to serve him because he served us first, he loved us first, and he cared for us first. Again, you must see him as your daddy and wants that you want to do good things to him because he's good to you. He's not a bad dad. Okay. And he says here, and being fully convinced that what he had promised he was able to perform. Simple question. My wife knows if I should say to her, give her a promise. Listen, I promise you so and so, or listen, tomorrow morning, 5 o'clock, so and so. Is she gonna believe me or she's not gonna believe me? She knows me already, my character. So does she have any doubt that I will not perform what I say? She will believe me. Am I right? Okay. So I want to say to you the same thing. You now have a father, which is our father, your real dad, not your earthly dad. And when he says, I have made a promise to you, then you must say, I believe and I'll receive it. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because I want you to understand that our Father is a Father that does not lie. He's a Father that does not lie. The problem is our mind has messed us up because people has messed us up. Because one person or our dad or our father or mother, I know same with my how many stepdads and my real father and even my mother. I could never count on them. You know, simple example. I waited. They said, now I'll get you off to school so and so. I waited till the sun went down and they forgot me so many times. And then sometimes I had to walk home. Or they forgot and pick up me up late. Do you understand? So it started off from a young age where I was rejected and their yes was not their yes. Do you hear? Now we come to the Lord and we have the same thing. And now we need to say to ourselves, no, God is true. My mother or my father or people mess me up, but God is my Father. That will never mess me up. When He says yes, it's yes. And He always yes and it's amen. Do you understand? He will always say to you yes. It might not be in the season that you receive it, but you will receive it. Do you understand? But He is a God that is your Father, and He's a good Father that wants the best for you. And He says, and therefore it was accounted to Him for righteousness. Because we believe Jesus died on the cross. So that's our righteousness. Now the other stuff is the mindset thing that messes us up. Yeah, but I'm not sure, Lord, is God really going to give me this? Whatever. No, God will give it to you at the right season sometimes. Because I say to people, many times I try to explain to people that God is a good God. That there's something you have to understand about my Father, which is also your Father, which is in heaven. God has a mind and God has a heart. Okay? So His heart concerning you is say, listen, Lawrence, you are blessed. You are holy. You are sanctified. He says, Lemuel, you are wealthy. You are debt-free. You know what? I'm seeing, I'm giving you 2 Lamborghinis. I've seen you 5 houses. That's His heart towards you. He sees you being healing the sick and raising the... That's His heart to you. The heart towards Vicky. Vicky, you're going to do mighty things. You're going to do great exploits. That's His heart. I see you can have 5 cars. You know, that's His heart towards you. His mind says to him, which is, you know, His truth side. His grace and His truth. You know what? I'm going to give that to Lawrence, but not now. I'm going to give this to him, but not now. Because I wish walking to a place. That's going to happen to Vicky, but not now. Because of so-and-so, but I'm helping him through to get to that place. It's a good father. It's like you see your kids one day. Yes, Caden, or, you know, he's going to be a preacher. He's going to be whatever, and so-and-so, and so. Am I right? That's how I see him in my heart. But now, okay, so what am I going to do? Okay, Caden, next week you can come here. You can start preaching and healing the sick, and I want a sermon for you. He's 6 years old. Do you understand? He's 6 years old. Now I say to you, I've given you everything. Now start preaching. Would he be able to do it? No, not yet. Okay. But God, so through my stuff, through my understanding of schooling in Him and seeing my wife, whatever, what's going to happen? He's going to become just like me up there one day. Ministering, doing stuff, healing the sick, whatever. You understand? Because if I give God, said to me the one, if I should give everything that my heart is desiring for you right now, it will kill you. It will destroy you. And we need to understand that. That's why we get disappointed. But I ask God, why am I getting it? So God, it's the liar or something. Do you understand? God is truth. He doesn't lie. But we need to hear from the Lord. Lord, I thank you that you are able to give me this, Lord. And if it's not, you remove it, you'll show me something else. But Lord, I thank you that you are a good Father. Do you understand how we should approach that and understand that? Because we have this bad thing in Pentecostal churches. We claim, we frame, and that's how it is. My heart for every single person here is to be multimillionaires. Do you know that? Every single person here. But some people is going to be a multimillionaire before somebody else. It doesn't mean there's favoritism. It's just one person is renewing their mind quickly and understanding the thing to move up quickly. Do you understand? That's all it is. That's all it is. You see, poverty is a mindset. That's all it is. God, okay, to understand God is a mindset. Our belief system, our foundation concerning God is totally warped. And we need to build that. The Bible says, do not be conformed to this world, but by the renewing of our mind. We need to put our mindset on how God sees us, also knowing This is how God sees us. But there's steps and things for us to get to where we should be. Because that's a good father. That's a good father. See, God has unconditional grace to us. So there's sometimes we know that there's a serious situation and God needs to come through us. God will come through it for us instantly. But there's some situations which is not that critical, but God will give to us, but when the time is more right. Do you hear? Because He's a good Father. We struggle with this thing that God is just this constant button. When we confess, we believe, when we tithe, and we sow, instantly things must just happen. Not always so. But does it happen? Yes, it does. Do we still thank God for speaking the word, believing it? Of course we do those things. It's for our benefit. But God, we don't have to beg God for money. We don't have to pray for 7 hours for God to give us a car. It's not how it operates. We just know, Lord, I thank you for this car will come. I thank you, Lord, for the millions will come. Lord, I thank you for that. Because that's what you want to give to me, Lord. Lord, I thank you. You see, one thing we need to understand is that if God should just give every single desire for us right now, right, all the time, what will happen to us? Naturally speaking, you have a boy or a girl, you give them everything, every day. When they open their mouth, I want this, I want it, you give it to them. What's going to happen to them? Spoiled brats. Do you understand? Have you seen all those wealthy people that just gives their kids all the time everything? What happens to those kids? Get into drugs, get into stuff, you know, rehabs, then this, and they're destroying their lives. Am I right? Now let's look at the same thing with God. That's why we have this all this grace. One guy, he says one day, you know, God just is, you just want to give you, He's giving you everything all the time. I said, if it's really the truth that God gives us everything all the time, then you don't need me. You don't need church. Then God is anywhere a cosmic butler. But God is busy schooling us, giving us understanding, the Holy Spirit teaching us and helping us to understand this family and how God is. And now we're growing into that. And now, you see, it's like a good father that has a multi-billion dollar industry. And one day his son must take over. He will school him from ground up into this company. So one day when he sits there, he will not destroy that company. Am I right? But in this process, he will not lack. In this process, he will learn. Because that father will help and love and nurture. Do you understand? Because that's a good father. That's a good father. You see, you need to understand. That's how God wants to operate in the kingdom. That's why it says work out your salvation. There's a working out. There's an understanding with God and this grace thing. We believe Jesus is Lord. But there's still a process that's busy happening for us to know where we're fitting and how we work with the Lord. Because God works with Vicky a bit different than with me. But it's still the same. Do you understand? God has maybe a bit more grace in a specific area than for me. But it doesn't mean I don't have grace. I mean, the Lord said to me one day when I was still single, and this guy was saying, yeah, you know, Johan, it's easy for you to say, because you're a single guy, you don't have to worry about kids and everything, and I must work for my kids and whatever, so, you know. And I said, yeah, maybe you're right. And the Lord rebuked me. He said, Johan, no. It says, don't you think I will give him more grace, because he needs more grace, to look after those kids? Do you understand? It doesn't mean I don't have grace at all. But where sin abound, much more grace abound. Now, I'm looking at the principle, not the sin. Where you need more grace for helping, so God says, I need to help more. You are still okay. So I need to help this person more. But it doesn't mean God can do everything at the same time. He can. But do you understand what I'm trying to say to you? I want you to understand that concept with the Lord. This is how God operates. I want you to see this stuff, but we still, this Jewish thing and the law thing and stuff, we still want to work this thing. We still want to work our heart to believe God. So I want to say to you tonight from this part one, you know what? Don't be like the law people. Don't try to work stuff. And when we do stuff, we feel good. No, we inherently do things because we do things. And yes, it makes us feel good, but we don't do things to make us feel good. We just do things and we feel good. Do you hear what I'm saying? We don't pray to make us feel better. We just pray and then we just feel better. Do you understand what I'm saying? We just help people. We don't want to help people to make us feel better. No, we help people and in that we feel better. Do you understand how it operates? And I want you to see this. This is the grace of God. We miss it. We think God just loves us and love it, guys and guys. We have all these grace teachers there. Thank God for them. But doesn't grace also, your kid that you grow up, don't you sometimes give him a hiding? Why do you give him a hiding? Because you like it. No, because you don't like it. Do you understand? But God is not like, you know, he doesn't beat you to death and whatever. You know what? He speaks to your heart. He ministers the word, comes to you, and he speaks to you in hope, but convicts you of righteousness. This is not who you are. Because when God speaks to you, you feel, he doesn't have to hit you so you can feel something. Do you understand? When he speaks, you'll really feel crap. That's how he works. When God speaks to you, know, it's like you know you've did somebody wrong, and the Holy Spirit convicts you, yes, go make them right with that person. But he didn't come and hit you against the head, go and make right with the person. No, he spoke, you have that conviction in you. How can it be fun? Sorry. Do you understand? That's how the Father operates with rebuke. How he operates with chastisement. Do you understand? Do you hear? Many times we do not give in to Holy Spirit. Then we go through painful experience and we say, yeah, God is teaching me something. No, you didn't listen to God from the beginning. How many times have you told your children, don't, what do they do? They do. What happens to them? They burn their hands. So whose fault was that? Their fault. But what do? Come, let me help you. Do you hear what I'm saying? So they go now through painful experience. They didn't give in to Lemuel's, you know. They didn't give in. Lemuel told his kid, listen, come on, Caleb. Then listen. Bumpy stoner. Told you shouldn't kick that. But anyway, let me help you. You know what I'm saying? We should have never had a sore toe if you just listened from the beginning. That is still unconditional grace. That is still the love of God. That is still the Father's heart caring for us. But we cannot see that. A father serves his children. His children doesn't serve him. Do you understand? That's what God does. We as parents serve our children. How do we serve them? Make sure they have food. Make sure they have this. Maybe sometimes they need extra pocket money for so-and-so. But they, you don't, when they scream, you give them every single thing. Do you understand? You don't do that. But sometimes you do it, give them extra because you love them, or they need for extra outing to need for something extra, then you give it to them. Do you understand? Am I drawing a picture for you to understand how beautiful grace is and how God actually operates? It's actually very simple because it's in your daily lives. It's in your daily lives. You see? And then one day, because you are helping your kid, look at this. One day, you are helping your kid so much. Okay? You're doing in his, he loves you so much and so much. Don't you think that your reward is to tell people, to show people, this is my son. Yes, you know, my son is a doctor, you know what? You know, and he says, you know what? My dad is better than me. No, my son is, you know. No, my dad. No, my son. You see the relationship that happens? And he will say to your dad, I would have never made it if it wasn't for you to help me in this way, you know? You made me to be a man. Or you, mother, you know what? Mother, you know. I'm like a woman now today because what you put into my life. Isn't that how it should be? And then one day they, you know what, for just to use the money concept, because people understand, that's why I minister a lot on that finances, people understand it. The one day they make a lot of money, and I said, you know what, I just want to say thank you, here's a house for you. Thank you, Mom. Thank you, Dad, you know? Do you understand what I'm saying? It's just giving back, but they don't have to. They don't feel obligated to. Do you understand? The whole thing is with good parenting. It's how God is. Now, let's be honest with you, okay? I'm saying honestly with me, my dad, and my mother. Can I tell you something? I don't really want to visit them. I don't like visiting them. Do you understand? But a good parent, have kids that wants to visit them. We have Kayla and Tegan. I've got a TV there and a TV there and everywhere. You know where they come to? My room TV. Everybody. You know? I do everything for them to do that and stuff. Nope, they come and they want to be with me. But you still want to be with me. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because now it shows you that there is something happening because they want to be with me or they want to be with my wife. Do you understand? With their mother. How many people do not want to be with their mothers? They don't want to be with their fathers. How many? I'm one of them. Do you understand? And that's what's happening with God. That you actually want to spend time with them. You want to hear what they say. In other words, what happens is now your child goes through something hectically in their life. Your daughter goes into womanhood. Your son goes into manhood. Okay? Now, they have such a beautiful relationship with you. Okay? They're not going to go to a stranger or to their friends. Mom, I don't know how the sex things work. So you're going to go to their mom. They're not going to go to the TV or to a movie or whatever. They're going to go to your dad. I don't know about this thing about, you know. So they're going to go to their dad. Because there's a relationship happening. Do you understand? How many, when I grew up, I never had that. I had to find out through media and stuff. Messed me up, man. Do you understand? That turned me into lust. It didn't turn me into anything else. Do you understand what I'm saying? It messed me up. But now with understanding God and understanding this stuff, now we need to understand this is how Father operates. When you're understanding how good He is to you, and I want to tell it continues how good He is to you, even sometimes if you don't get your way, He is still good to you because He wants to protect you. You know, same thing with your kids, and I want to use this example with the kids that I have and so forth, is that I can be angry at them, but in a good way. I just said, no, you will not, and this is enough now, whatever. No. They don't stay away from me from hours. They said, sorry, whatever. 10 minutes later, hello, oh my God, let's go watch a movie. You know what I'm saying? They don't feel so rebuked and so like belittled that I don't even want to come near me for the next 10 hours. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is relationship. This is the family thing of grace that God wants to show you and He's busy showing me. The Bible says this, and very interesting, I never understood it. If you read in Genesis and also in Jude, only two places in the Bible talks about Enoch. And it says this. Enoch was 65 years old. 65. Then he had kids. Then he had kids and walked with God and was no more. Because God took him. He was 365 years old. He only understood the true value of how God was when after he had received kids. And he understood this is how God operates. Family. I never understood family. And God started revealing to me stuff here and things. And I said, since I got married, I had an awesome wife and the kids. And the kids is not even my kids, my real blood and flesh kids. But they're like my kids. I mean, that's weird. I mean, it shows me something. It's like this. God. It's like I'm actually adopted by God. So it's like the same thing for me. But it's real. Like God is real. You see, it's like we were sinners. We were not even whatever. And God adopted us and said, come now, you're my son. He did the same thing. But it's about understanding. I want you to look at stuff. And I want to say sorry for what people did wrong to your mother, your father, your cousin, your whatever. They messed you up. But I want you to say, it's time for you to look at it a different way. And to see, you know, what God's unconditional grace is like a family, a godly family. You might not always get your way. Okay? But you'll get it in some way. Do you hear what I'm saying? That's the beautiful grace that God has for you and for me. Amen. Amen. And don't fall onto works. Because I want you to understand what the whole thing is, this law thing, that to work out things in law. Don't try to work too hard in enjoying God. I mean, do I have to really work hard to enjoy my wife? No. I don't have to work hard to enjoy my wife. You know what I'm saying? It's not hard. It's a pleasure. Do you hear what I'm saying? It's a pleasure. Does it mean sometimes, you know what, she does something to me or says something that I feel a bit, of course. You know? Do I, vice versa. But do we stay there? Is it totally upset and that's oblivion forever and a day? And I'm like, you know, no. Like I said the other day, so a while back, we had a bit of a tiff. Yes, we had some tiffs. You know? But nothing hectic, but I was just thinking, and I just went, and she said, so you're going to be quiet with me? I said, no, man, you know what? You know I can't be, because God convicts me and the Spirit is me, so I can't be angry with you anymore. And blah, 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 and I just make a joke, we laugh, and went on. You know? We just made a joke and laugh, and we went on. I said, because I can't, because I know. You know, it's too much of God in me. It's too much of God in my wife. It's too much God all around us, that we cannot be angry at all. It's like this with God. Why would God be angry with you all the time? Why must you be angry with God all the time? Come on. Imagine you're always angry with your kids all the time. That's wrong. Do you understand? Amen.